I'm Anthony Williams. I'm a writer and journalist, a member of Level Ground, and I've seen it 4 times in theaters.
I'm Dave Thompson, and I'm a singer-songwriter and poet. This is my second time seeing it.
I'm Chance Calloway. I am a filmmaker, and this was my 4th time seeing it. I own it. I haven't watched it at home. I only watch it on the big screen.
So I guess we'll just start and say, it's not too much to say that this is an historic film. I wonder, with you being artists of one form or another, and what about the film struck you your first time to see it? And then on subsequent viewings, were there things that jumped out at you that you may have missed before, or that challenged or inspired you in a new way?
It sounds cliche, but it really was just that experience of kind of like finally seeing yourself on the screen. We've seen gay stories, LGBT, but I think just the levels of it, because it was Black, gay, impoverished, all of those stories. So the first time I saw it, I remember just seeing him being bullied, the like romance tinged with the bullying and all of that, that just really hit home. I was like kind of like all over the place in the theater.
Yeah, I feel like the first time I was overwhelmed because I was struck by so much of it all at the same time. So there was definitely the whole representation part. Me being a Black man, me being a gay man, me being a guy who grew up poor, but then also just the filmmaking, like the quality was so high. Because usually when you hear like it's a Black gay film, like, oh, okay, like you know what that is. And this was not that at all, so I was just I was really surprised.
I like the fact that it wasn't over dramatic, because I feel like with a lot of Black gay films, it's over-sexualized, it kind of pinpoints the sexuality of it, and this was more of like a real story. It wasn't too much, it wasn't, you know, too little, it was like just right, and the combination of both those things, you know, from like him growing up, like the story behind it, other than the fact that him being gay, it was powerful to see like how all that unwind and like, you know, him trying to find himself, and like, you know, I really like that.
So, kind of same question though, on subsequent viewings, was there anything at all that was different or that jumped out? What do you think?
I mean, because you start to see some of the parallels, you start to see some of the bookends. I wondered how much of it was done on purpose. You know, I got to hear Barry speak about it, so I know some of it was done on purpose, some of it I think was just coincidental. But when you watch it again, I think you just kind of marvel at the fact that they told a story and they allowed the characters to just exist at their corner of intersection. And that's not something that you typically get for either a gay story or a Black story. It was fascinating to me because this wasn't a cautionary tale about a gay man. This wasn't a cautionary tale about a poor person growing up in the hood. You know, like other beats, while on the surface they felt familiar, they weren't at all in execution. So that's when I really realized the power of this film is that, oh my gosh, like they allowed you just to live in this world. And they didn't, I think you said it, you know, they didn't make it melodramatic or make you feel like you had to learn something. You were just a part of their lives for these 3 snippets of his life, and you were just allowed to live in it.
I think the second time I saw it, when Juan takes Sharon back to the apartment, and Paula is like trying to figure out what happened, and when he kind of like wants to give Sharon like a handshake or whatever, and she pulls him away, I didn't see that the first time. Well, I guess I saw it, but the second time I saw it, it's not just that she doesn't know who this dude is, she's like, oh, she knows who that dude is. And then me and my friend had the same kind of thinking process where when Sharon, when he's going back to the school to like get his vengeance, on the second or the repeat viewings, it just seemed like there were so many more doors for him to go through. Like, when you first saw it, you're just kind of in the moment, but then when you're watching it again, it's almost like you're more anxious, like, God, I don't remember there being this many doors for me to do.
Or to not go through it.
Yeah.
Like, at any moment, you cannot do that.
Yeah.
Right? There are so many themes that I'm anxious to kind of get into, to just hear your thoughts on. I wonder, before we do that, if there are things that you want to talk about. When you see this film, and you've seen it four times and twice and four times, what is that? What are those themes that jump out at you that you say, I've got to talk about this with someone?
I think for me, like especially like watching gay films, there's always like this, the characters play into like the stereotype of what people think gay means. I like the fact like how Chiron like it's like it was like real, but then it was like dang, like I mean I feel like that's how everyone is, like, you know, he was a shy kid, you know, when he was growing up, and then he flipped and turned into this thing that he thought that he had to be, you know, like he went from being shy and quiet to like this drug lord, you know, like it's like he changed because he felt like he had to fit into like this like heteronormative thing, you know. He's still, even at the age, like, and close to the end of the movie, like he's an adult now, but he's still trying to find himself, you know. But it's just interesting because in films, especially like with women, you know, you get the same kind of like vibe of like, oh, like a softball player or a basketball player, you know. It's like this idea of what it means to be gay, like you have to be an athlete or you have to be this. And like with Chiron, like, you know, he was just this kid, you know, going through stuff in his life, and, you know, him being shy and like not really having like a voice, so to speak, to grow up to be this man, you know, that's hard, quote unquote hard, and things like that. It just, I thought it was interesting to see how his environment kind of shaped him into something that he necessarily may not have wanted to be. But it seems that that is the case most of the time. You're on this journey trying to figure out, like, who am I supposed to be? Like, yeah, I'm gay, but like, does that mean I have to fit into the depiction of what people think gay is? Or do I just be myself? And even in being yourself, you're still put into these categories that necessarily, like, you don't want to be in, you know? And everybody's affected by it, whether or not you want to be. You want to be kind of outside of the norm, you still kind of move in that capacity, even though you don't want to be, you know? So I thought it was cool to see that, not in such a way that it was like, you know, so much, but it was like, okay, it makes sense. Like, he's in Florida, he's, you know, his mentor, his father figure was this guy, and he ended up kind of becoming Juan in that sense. But I thought it was interesting just to see how things play out. When you see it on screen, it's like, dang, like, yeah, this really does happen. Like, we morph into what people want us to be, even though we don't necessarily want to be what people want us to be, if that makes sense.
Yeah, in the varying degrees, because you see that with Chiron and with Kevin. Kevin said the same thing, but they just kind of went these like parallel paths. I just always go back to like the humanity, because it is just like this little boy that's like lost. I mean, and from the very beginning, he's a little boy, and they're calling him faggot. And so if it's not that, or he's black, so he should be this way. That's what I've told my family. Like, my mom still hasn't seen it. A lot of my family still hasn't seen it, but the ones that do, I would just go about it that way, and then I connect to them on that level, because there's just so many things that we haven't addressed. Even though they may be cool with me, they haven't talked to me about being bullied or that kind of level of humanity of like, I never realized how you may have felt lost. So that's the main thing, the humanity.
The third portion of the film is just so romantic. Just that entire, you know, that cafe scene, I just, like, I feel like I'm just holding my hand over my heart the whole time. Because growing up, I grew up in a small town in Georgia, and my father's a pastor. So you can just imagine the kind of environment I grew up in and hearing, being in the Black community and the Christian Black community, you know, like just gayness is bad, it's a sin, it's all these terrible things. And when you watch a movie like this, and you see the purity of it, right? You know, like they don't sully it, they just allow it to be pure and lovely, and you're just looking at them look at each other, and you're just like, oh my gosh, you know? Like, we don't get movies like that. So for me, that was just like, I was just weeping. That got me the second time I saw it, because the first time I cried, like, from the beginning. Second time, like, okay, I got this, I know what's happening. And then that whole scene, I just was crying, and I was on a date, and that was so bad. But it's just kind of like, you realize, man, I didn't, you know, like, we can just let this be romantic, let this be sweet, let this be love, and that, to me, was huge.
I don't know where to go with this, but I find it interesting, the people who I know that complain the most about the ending are, in my case, were like the closeted gay boys in college who didn't give me the time of day, but like, will a friend request you years later because, oh, you're in LA, you're doing something now. And then like, they went and saw Moonlight for whatever reason on their own volition, and they're like, I didn't like the ending. And like, I haven't talked to these dudes in like 4 years, but they want to talk to me about how they didn't like the ending. And then I'm having to tell them about, you know, it's not about the sex, it's about, he wasn't even ready to have sex. He hadn't been touched by him in like probably a decade, so it was about the intimacy being seen.
Yeah. When Chiron tells him, you're the only man that ever touched me,
right?
How do you not weep in that moment, right? Because of this, the basic human instinct of wanting to be touched and held and known and loved. And a good friend of mine who had seen the film pointed out to me that this film tackles something that virtually no film does, gay or straight, which is non-sexual male intimacy.
Yes.
Where have you seen that in another movie? I can't name
them. I mean, and they start from the beginning with the whole, you know, you gotta show them that you ain't soft kind of thing. And I'm like, man, how many conversations had I had like that with my friends who always trying to like toughen me up so I wouldn't seem, you know, so I wouldn't seem gay? When those are two completely different things. You know, you can be tough and gay, you can be soft and gay, you can be soft and straight. But there's so many different layers of like the masculinity that they were approaching in this movie. Like the fact that the drug dealer was cool having a conversation about, are you a faggot or not? You know, like, that blew my mind. And, like, Barry and Terrell just didn't shy away from, like, touching all aspects of it.
This is one of those cases, the first time that we saw it, when it ended, we looked at each other, a colleague of mine and I, and said, we've never seen anything like this. Which is probably a dual indictment of both what we expose ourselves to and what the industry creates, to be quite honest. So to watch this and then to hear, we might have been at the same screening with the Q&A after. When you realize how so much of this is born out of Terrell and Barry's experiences, right? That they knew a guy, the drug dealer taught him how to ride a bike, right? And there's also a bit, like when you watch this film, it's incredibly sad, but then if you stop to think at the end, the potential for further stories, right? That this might open doors for, that we hope it opens doors for. So we can say every time we see a movie, I've never seen anything like that. As opposed to saying, well, it's the same thing over and over again, right? So I wonder if maybe one final thing, and maybe we can turn to the audience for some feedback. We are at a kind of faith and art event. And I had a friend who saw the film and said that for him, Chiron's story was a Christ-like story. That if you watch in the final, one of the final scenes in the first act, Chiron is baptized by Juan in the ocean. John the Baptist. He's beaten in high school as a teenager. And in the final act, he refuses to enact vengeance on people that abused him. And essentially gets down off his cross and enters into this kind of redemptive, potentially redemptive relationship. I wonder if there are thoughts that you had watching it from a faith perspective or spirituality or however you draw those lines. What were thoughts that you had along those? Because so much of it... so much of identity is tied up with spirituality and religion, and especially in America, right? And how does that, you know, where are some of those intersections?
It's a tough nut to crack. I honestly, I didn't go there immediately on my first viewing, other than just like looking at my own life and just thinking about like my father's side of the family is very churchy. Like my grandfather is like this church dynasty, and all his sons want to be preachers, but they're not. It's a whole thing. But yeah, I definitely see that. And I think that's kind of like going back to what Dave said. It just goes back to show that it's not falling into any kind of like tropes or any kind of like Tyler Perry-ish. No offense to Tyler Perry.
He owns an island, you know.
And that matters. He tells stories that reach people, and we hadn't got a lot of stories like this that reach people. But yeah, all that stuff hits. I think that's why it hit us, because that's one of the greatest stories ever told, and it's those same levels.
Yeah, I'll also say that I didn't quite go to the place of like Christ imagery with this, only because I had a high school teacher who's always taking every story and turning it into something Christ-like. I was like,
okay. Yeah, and this works here because it's not violent, right?
Right,
all
exactly.
Those other cases, it's like Superman killed somebody. Well, that's not Jesus. Right. He didn't kill him.
Yeah. But in this case, I think whenever you talk about like male intimacy, you always are going to think about like if you read the Bible a lot like I do, like the story of David and Jonathan. Because that's one of, of course, the great big debates. People are like, oh, well, they were totally gay for each other. But like whether or not they were gay for each other, it's they definitely loved each other. And what I like about this ending is everyone has different opinions of where Chiron and Kevin go after this. But like it kind of doesn't matter because you see where they are. And it's definitely a place of love. Whether that goes into sexual love or lifelong love, there is such a closeness that they have and a bond that they share, and it's kind of like that's what matters. And when I think about that, because I have a lot of close relationships with friends who are straight, and I think, you know, wow, you know, this, we're kind of weirdly close, but there's nothing sexual or romantic about it. It's just intimacy that, because I don't have that wall as a gay man, I've kind of broken down some of the walls that they may have had, and the closest that we have is something that's just really healthy. And so when I see this movie and I kind of see that, it's like, it doesn't really matter where Kevin and Chiron go as a couple. It just matters, in my opinion, that they love each other.
Yeah, I didn't go to the realm of like being like Christ-like, but I think you had said about like being seen, like this idea of like really being seen, I think it's something that, I mean, as Christian, as whatever religion you are, or just human in general, like to see somebody, like that is like the ultimate, I think, act of love, you know? I think especially the ending scene when Chiron is laying on his chest, it's just something about that, because the idea of like being touched and to be embraced, like that is like such a beautiful thing. And I just feel like when you say like being intimate, like it's so crazy, like how, you know, we see things like as people. Like I could have like a girl best friend, we're together all the time, but doesn't mean like we're having sex or anything like that. But like people go straight to that just because you hang out with somebody or you're close with someone and you're, you know, being intimate with someone doesn't necessarily mean that you're having like an amorous relationship. It just means that you love that person. And I just feel like our minds are so like warped and messed up that we're constantly thinking about what people are doing in the bedroom rather than, you know, just, oh, they just exist and they exist with each other rather than, oh, you know, you're boning or something like that. Like it doesn't have to be that way, but I just feel like people go to that. But I just feel like this idea of intimacy, and I feel like if more people were more vulnerable and real, like a lot of issues and problems that we have nowadays wouldn't exist if we were more intimate with each other and more honest and more, you know, raw and, you know, uncut. Like if we were just, you know, basically metaphorically naked in front of each other, like it would be more open to change and more open to understanding, which I feel like this film normalizes what people think is not normal. You know, being gay in general, like this film normalizes it because you get to see into the lives of a person. You know, it's not this, you know, crazy, like freakish, you know, sexually driven thing. It's about relationship. Like, you know, when you think about straightness, you don't go straight to sex, but when it comes to being gay, you go straight to sex. But it's about being human. Like, you know, me being gay doesn't make me like a freak or, you know, or a deviant, you know, so.
Yeah, it's one of those rare films that it's almost like a lesson in empathy, right? That you can watch and it's, you can feel like it, there's a feeling to it, right? And I think it's all tied up, and I think at one point or another you've all talked about, it's just also a damn fine movie. Like, it's well made, it's executed at the highest level, and that draws you in, right? And helps you, and helps crush those boundaries, right, between the screen and the audience. I wonder from the audience if there's anybody that wants to say like a word or two about their response to the film, especially if this was your first time to see it. And then what do we think? 2-3 years from that right. moment, culture is going to say, uh-uh.
Right.
You can't
right.
do that anymore. Right? Yeah. Anybody else? Okay. Oh, wait. Sorry. Yep.
It's my second time, too, if it's okay. Yeah, I want to know your guys' thoughts. So I guess the part that I don't know what to feel about it is the last, you know, when he's an adult, I think it's cool that he's like strong, and there's a lot of him that, you know, he symbolizes Juan a lot. But it kind of makes me sad that like he ended up being a drug dealer. When you remember like when he was little, he was just so brokenhearted. He was like, "Oh, are you a drug dealer? Like, does my mom do drugs?" And just how devastated he was, and then he fell into that. When I don't know, I feel like I wanted something better for him. I wanted him to be like this successful, like businessman, like a legal businessman, I guess. Yeah. So I don't know, like what are your guys' thoughts about that?
I think that's just going back to humanity. That's what we all do. We kind of grow up and we look at our parents and the environment around us and we hate certain aspects, and then you may try something and it doesn't work, or you're hurt, or you experience pain, and you just go back to what's familiar. He went back to that. He was really hurt. He was crushed. He had to go and start a new life. And he's like, I'm going to just build myself up and no one can hurt me anymore, which is kind of no different than, you know, those of us who've been hurt in the church, and either you try something new or you run away from it, or they, you know, become this, you know, the thing they hate, where they're like in the midst of the church and like acting against what their true self.
Yeah, I think from a storytelling aspect, it's very powerful that he ended up becoming a drug dealer, because again, like you said, like lesson, like an empathy, I think Samantha said, you know, like no easy answers or something similar to that, because it would have been easy for us to sympathize, like, oh, he was a struggling little boy and now he's, you know, a lawyer or a school teacher or something like that. It would have been so easy to say, oh, yay, good for him, you know, what happened to him? But then for him to be a drug dealer, because I remember when I saw it the first time, I'm glad you brought that up, because I was like, oh God, drugs, you know, because I just, like, so we're going to go there now? Yeah, fun. And then it didn't go anywhere, again, it didn't go where I expected, and it challenged my perception. I actually was on the metro a little later on after I watched it the first time, and these two dudes got next to me, they were really loud, and they're the type of guys I would usually, like, you know, kind of, like, shy away from. calling each other N-word all loud and stuff. I'm like, oh my God, you're embarrassing the culture. And this time I had just watched Moonlight and I was thinking like, yo, these dudes could just, you know, they could be like me. They could be gay. They could be having their own kind of struggles. And it was weird that like movie gave me an instantaneous change. Because I automatically thought, instead of, oh my God, you know, like these people might be dangerous, it's like, yo, they're just like me. They just got their own story that led them to this place, but we're on the same metro going somewhere in life. So I was kind of glad that they did that. I was glad that that they decided to let Chiron go to that, I guess, dark place as far as career is concerned.
Yeah, I would also say, like, to take note of when he is an adult and he's trying to, like, handle his, like, protege, you see him trying to be like Juan, but he's, like, horrible at it. He's almost a little bit too mean. He doesn't know how to do it, but he's just like, I'm trying to be hard, I'm trying to be playful, and I'm trying to, like, be intimate, you know, in that sense, not maybe sexually, just, like, have a connection, but he doesn't really know how to do it. He's still figuring it out.
I also, I kind of like the fact that he was a drug dealer, but not, like, the fact that he was a drug dealer. I like how it kind of put into perspective, like, going back to, like, the stereotypes, because, like, to be a man, quote-unquote, means to, like, you know, to be hard in the, like, how people view what masculinity is, but then also the juxtaposition of him being gay and being a drug dealer, like, that's, I mean, of course there are gay drug dealers, but, you know, most
who knows? Who sees them?
That's right, exactly, you know? So just like, I feel like that was a point that they might have tried to be making, like, you know, people, like, what does gay look like, you know? What does gay look like? But also, like, environment as well. Like, you know, he grew up in that area, so sometimes it's hard for people to kind of get out of that cycle of, you know, going a different path of, like, what you know, who taught you. It's, sometimes it's hard to do that. So I like the fact that it wasn't, like, this pretty bow tie in a package story. It was like, okay, we thought that he might end up being like this, you know, successful, you know, person just based off of, like, his story, like, you know, his mom was a drug addict and all these things, but he ended up going down the same path as, you know, Juan, or as what his environment may have said he was.
Join me in thanking our panelists.